This is your glory. If this is your morning, let it rain. If this is your power, if this is your glory, if this is your hallelujah, let it rain, let it rain all over me, let it rain.
Says where two or three are gathered in the place in your name, Lord, you are there in their midst. Therefore, we have no doubt that you are here with us. Lord, your angels are sitting right beside us. We say we thank you for this. Thank you for the ministry's angels that are located all over this room, this wonderful afternoon. May all glory, may all honor be ascribed unto your holy name. We pray, O Lord, for an open heart. We pray, O God, for a peaceful spirit. And we come against any foul spirit that is lingering in this atmosphere. We curse you to disappear in the name of Jesus Christ. We say fire unto you in the name of Jesus. You thief, we destroy your plan in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus. Whatever you have cooked, we have brought it to zero in Jesus' mighty name. Spirit of living God, we give you the permission to move. We give you the permission to freely flow in the midst of your people. Touch it and every soul here that they may feel you literally, Lord, that you visited them. We thank you. We honor you. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. Put your hands together for Jesus. Today we are going to look at Free Yourself from Yourself, Part 2. Free Yourself from Yourself, Part 2. I'm sure most of us, we can still remember this theme that we did. Was it 2 weeks ago or something? 2 weeks ago. But today is Free Yourself from Yourself, Part 2. And dear family, I would like us to turn our Bibles to the book of John 8, verse 36. John 8, verse 36. And a powerful scripture. This scripture was released by Jesus Christ himself. You know, Jesus Christ was a teacher. And through history, Jesus Christ is the greatest teacher that has ever lived. He is the greatest man that has ever lived, and he is the greatest teacher that has ever lived. He taught with simplicity, and he taught with authority. Hallelujah. And the Bible says in John 8 verse 36, it says that, so if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed. Now, in some other version, it says that if the Son makes you free, you will be free indeed. Before we come to the analysis of this scripture, I'd like us to look at another scripture. How will the Son set you free? Let us look at 1 Corinthians 6, verse 9 to 11. 1 Corinthians 6, verse 9 to 11. 1 Corinthians 6, verse 9 to 11. The Bible says that, or do you not know that wrongdoers will not inherit the kingdom of God? It's a question sign at the back. He says, do not be deceived.
Deceived means that don't be fooled.
Don't allow yourself for somebody to fool you. Neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor men who have sex with men, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor slanderers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. And verse 11 says that. And that is what some of you were. Thank God that it is where. It's past tense. But you were washed. You were sanctified. You were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. That sets us free. Hallelujah. These are the foundations of being set free. Once upon a time, we were out there in the world. Once upon a time, our hands were dirty. Once upon a time, we were adulterers. Once upon a time, we were fornicators. Once upon a time, we were thieves. I know somebody will ask me, thief, I never touched any grammar. But the thief is not, it's not only a physical thief that you go and take somebody something. And in fact, if you take somebody something without telling the person, it doesn't matter, even if it's from a company, you have stolen. That is stealing. Even the paper you collect from your company, you don't tell the boss, you have stolen. Did you tell somebody, is it your own? It's not your own. So we were once more, one time that, and sometimes we were even witches. You know, somebody can be a witch, you don't know that you are a witch. A witch is a woman who goes out in a place in the night and does destruction. A wizard is also a man on the other side who goes out in a kind of spiritual means and so on and cause havoc out there, either worrying the whole community or doing something that is, of course, not normal. And for your information, sometimes you can be a witch without you knowing. Many people, they grow up, and when they were little ones, they give them something in their mouth, they swallow. You don't know where you are. They just come to your house, they carry your baby, and before you notice, the baby is crying because he's in the house of somebody who is a tyrant. And sometimes the baby may not even cry. But the thing is, the baby has swallowed something. And that something is going to be in the baby's stomach. It's a seed that has been planted. It is going to be growing little by little as the baby is growing up. At one point in time, you will realize that the baby herself or the child at this moment begins to leave the body in the night and doing something else without the person per se knowing. The person will only be thinking that it's a dream. And before you notice, they have caught the person somewhere. Through some other kind of another kind of witch or a witch doctor. They have caught the person somewhere. The person herself, maybe when you question, say, oh, I don't know. Why people come to church even, they don't even know that they carry something in them. But when the word is administered and the spirit begins to move, you see people, they start manifesting. They start manifesting. Little did they know that certain things is in their belly. Or they are connected with the spiritual, with the dark spiritual world. I tell you, the world is not clean the way you move around. You see the street of Germany is clean. You see the trees, they are just bearing leaves and flowers, making the whole place to be beautiful. You think that it is all beautiful. No. It is not all rosy. Because if you rose flower, they have thorns. So Jesus Christ, in the book of John 8, 36, he was telling the disciples, he says that, so if the Son of Man makes you free or sets you free, you are free indeed. And when before he said this, he was telling the disciples that the truth, he who knows the truth, he shall set you free. You shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. This is part of his teachings. And the disciples, they were like, why should you tell us that if we know the truth will set us free? Now, do you know that we are children of Abraham? We are the children of Abraham.
And we are not caught. We have not been slaves. Nowhere. No, no place. So we are free people. Why should you say that? The truth will set us free. When we are free people, we are not pilgrims. We are not slaves under somebody's hand. Ah, Jesus says, no. You have sinned. You have sinned. And anyone who sins makes him or herself a slave to that sin. Hallelujah. So then comes this scripture here in 1 Corinthians. It begins to list all those things that people they go through. They sin. But at the end, it brings solution. And that is the freedom that you get. So Jesus tells them that if you are washed, if you repent, if you come to Jesus Christ, to himself, then he, the Son of Man, will set you free. And if he does that, you are free indeed.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Yeah. Would somebody be free today?
Amen.
Somebody is going to be free today from every entanglement of the enemy.
Amen.
Now sometimes the entanglement of the enemy, it is overstatement. Most of the time, the entanglements that we blame the enemy is not of the enemy. We only blame the enemy to the ground. But most of the entanglements, they are from ourselves. Oh yes, slavery is the using of one man upon the other. When you misuse a human being, you know, in those days when the slave trade was taking place, people, they come to Africa, they go to other places, they go and buy human beings. How can it be possible that you go and buy human beings? When you buy human beings, these human beings now become your personal property, and you can do anything you want to do with a human being because you have a right. It's just the same like just buying animals. In fact, it actually means that the animals here in this country, they are more important than you who was a slave at that time when you were bought. Because here there's animals' right. You don't kill animals anyhow. Even the cow that you eat as meat, you have a way, they have a way that they kill that cow so that the cow will not feel pain. If you kill a cow, then the cow will feel pain, you know that you are in big trouble. Do you know that? No, you don't know that. You will come to know, don't worry, as you grow up. So, but at that time, they were buying people, they take them to anywhere. So you can even slaughter a human being. Nobody will ask you anything. Because it's your property, you paid for it. It's the same thing, you go to the shop and buy a dress. You take the dress to your house. If you like to cut it, you cut it. Nobody will ask you, why did you cut it? Because there's no right and no law saying that when you buy a dress, you should not cut a dress. No, I have not read that one before. There are laws, so many laws in this country. But that one is free. You can cut a dress. So when you buy human beings, it is the same like you buy a dress. So this is the exploitation of man by man. So he can use you to do anything. You work, no pay. He beats you to work hard. Remember the children of Israel? While they were in Egypt, that is exactly what they were doing to them. Every day their quota were increased. Even things that they couldn't carry, they still increased and add more load for them. Hallelujah. But Jesus Christ is telling somebody today that you shall be free from all these things.
Amen.
But before you are free, he has to note and you must be able to identify these things that are holding you in bondage. What then is freedom? According to Martin Luther King Jr., it's submission to Christ through faith. Hallelujah. When you submit to Christ through faith, you are free. I can say 90%. 90% you are free. When I talk about faith, I'm talking about real faithfuls. Not churchgoers. In quote. You know, there are differences between somebody who goes to church, they call that person churchgoer, and somebody who is a believer. Because somebody, if they take you every day, this car, you can go and be sleeping in this garage that is right here. There is never a day you become a car. Will you become a car? You will not go and be swimming in the sea. Go to the sea, the river, and all pools, and swim there every day. If you like to sleep there, you sleep there. But I bet you, not one day, you think that they will call you a fish, you are a liar. They will never call you a fish. It's the same thing when you come to church. You come to these four walls. Come and meet believers. When they say amen, you also shout amen. And you do nothing with your soul and your spirit. Your spirit is not regenerated. It remains the same. You go back home like a dead cat goes into the river and comes back. It appears as if nothing happened. This is not the kind of faithfulness that Martin Luther King is talking about. He says submission, that is freedom. Submission to Christ through faith. This freedom allows for a joyous exchange. This exchange is joyous. A joyous exchange of the sinner's sin, death, and damnation. Now, most people, when they carry sin, they are happy. They are joyous with the sin. And they like to live with it. You advise somebody, oh, this, no. You become an enemy automatically. Say, leave me, it's my life. Leave me, it's my life. No. I tell you, there is no one of us here, including myself, standing here, that have my life.
Amen.
It's not my life. This one I live here is not my life.
Yeah.
I'm moving here, it's not my power, it's not my mind.
Yeah.
It's not my life. Yeah. And if God says, hey, Isaac, come here. I fall here now, I'm gone.
Yeah.
You will not see me anymore. And then I boast that this is my life. Leave me is my life. What did you just say?
Mercy, Lord. Mercy.
Wow. When people speak, they speak because they think they have everything. Go and ask Nebuchadnezzar. Brother Nebuchadnezzar, go and ask him. He spoke, he thought that he has power because of authority that he has in the country. But God arose and said, hello, you speak like this? Come on, go to the bush. And he took his two legs and went to the bush and was crawling on fours, eating grass. And animals, monkeys, deers, and wild pigs in the bushes. They became his friends. They became his friends. May it not happen to you like this. May it not be your portion. Amen. Oh, Jesus. Hallelujah. These guys, with this joyous sin that they do have, they are angry to exchange this sin, to exchange this death and damnation for Christ's grace, life, and salvation. What do we need again? What else do we need? When we have grace, we have life, we have salvation of Jesus Christ, what else do we need? Hallelujah. It's better that we begin to advise people and advise them well. It says that this freedom then allows the believer to become a dutiful servant. As we know, when you turn, you are changed. The next thing that you must do in the house of God is begin to serve. We are all called to be servants. We are servants of the Most High God. Because the life that He has given to us, it says that you are my ambassadors. You are a royal priesthood. A peculiar man. A precious generation. Who are you? I am a royal priesthood. What does priest do? Priest takes care of sheep. They take care of sheep. They preach the gospel. Amen.
Amen.
So we must engage ourselves into servanthood. God has called us to be His ambassador on earth here. When you move all around here, you preach to people, what are you doing? You are giving them visas to go to heaven.
Amen.
You are giving them visas to go to heaven. Hallelujah. And when they get to that gate of heaven, they will see Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ said, who are you? He said, I am that one that Joyce gave me visa. Ah, yeah. That is the embassy I planted in your head. Enter, come. That is it. You get visa. I want you to, you come. You watch. Ah, you see your people there. They are enjoying. Hallelujah. Mm-hmm. They say, thank you. Thank you, Sister Joyce. If not of you, if not of this visa, I don't know where I would have been now. Of course, you should know where you have been. You are in a place that is shining gold on the floor and you are moving in the freedom of charge. You would have been in hellfire and jumping there. Iron are in the hellfire. When you jump, you touch one. You know where iron is in the hellfire? You know what happened? No, not even in hellfire. In fire, when you put iron in fire, it's hot. And so you who is jumping there, you go and touch anyone iron, you know what is going to do? It fries you and then you jump again from that side, and this other side. If but death, there is no death. There is only what? Gnashing of teeth. That is what the Bible says. Gnashing. You grind your teeth until your muscles or your jaw will become so thick like this. People who refuse this offer, that is the fate that they are going to suffer. Amen. So we must become dutiful servants of the Most High God. Because we are stewards. We are going to give an account of this life that He has given to us. He has given us life to live and to live it well. Not allow the enemy to steal anything. The Bible says in John 10:10, the thief comes not, but to do what? To steal, to kill, and to destroy. That is why Jesus abandoned His throne in heaven. Came down that you may have life and have it abundantly. And that abundant life is what you need to enjoy on this precious earth that God placed you here. Amen. Amen. You need to enjoy abundant life. Don't allow the enemy to penetrate. Don't allow all those gates that are open. Close them all from the enemy to penetrate in your life. And you yourself, don't allow your own self to put weight upon you. Don't allow your own self to put a break from your forward movement. Most of the time we want to win, but our own self is fighting us. And so when we see the enemy, we have two enemies that we are fighting. Fighting our own selves and fighting the enemy. We are fighting now on two fronts. Sometimes it can be difficult to win. You fight when you carry load. Your own self, your own desires. Those ones that the Bible calls, it says that they are fleshy things. These are the things I'm talking about. That they are our own desires. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So, he says that from his prepared remarks, all this, when it happens, it does what? If it happens that the unbeliever surrenders the thing, what does he do? Or you, who is a believer, you repent of your sins. What happens? You are being thrust again into that new life. It pushes you again into that new life. You don't stay anymore in bondage. This life that we live is a life of cleansing. That is the reason why we always say, be filled with the Holy Spirit. Be filled with the Holy Spirit. You say, oh, last year I was filled with the Holy Spirit. I don't have any space again. When we walk upon the face of this earth, we have challenges. There are blows that come. There are slaps that come. There are stones that the enemy throws upon us. He throws dust. Sometimes mosquitoes come and suck us out from all this strength that we come and tank here in this spiritual filling station. And it's getting dry. So next time when you come, it must be filled again so that it will give you another distance that you can run. You cannot run on a car cannot run on an empty tank. Isn't it? Can a car run on an empty tank? No. If you have a journey that you are going, the Bible says that the race is not for the swift. Neither is the battle for the strong. But time and chance happens to them all. Hallelujah. You are a long ranger, a long race that you still need to go. You are not stopping today. You are not dying today. You are not driving only around Germany. You are driving above. Because what? He has given us power to do what? To conquer Samaria. To conquer Judah. To conquer the uttermost part of the world. You are not only evangelizing here. You are not building up your muscles only for Kaiserslautern. Not only for Germany. It is not only for Europe, but for the whole world.
Amen.
So your tank must always be filled, ready to take up that challenge. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. So number one, we need to evaluate yourself. What? You evaluate yourself so you can be able to block yourself from your own self, not allowing your own entanglement to be upon you. Block yourselves from yourself. Evaluate yourself worth. How much do you worth? Can you stand in a place and say, oh, people now, they go, I see many people, they say, Bill Gates, he is now worth something, 100 and something billion or million euros or dollars. That is their own worth that they are calculating in terms of carnal things. But If I may ask you a question, or you may ask yourself, how much do I worth in this society? How do you see yourself? How do you classify yourself? You will know how much you worth by the places that you go, by the people you join with. How many of you have seen and they are mentally in this school? If I told you, even I tell one. If I see how many of you have seen, I know you don't go to this school. But if she went to this school, it will not hide. You will see it on television. You will see it on YouTube. You will see it everywhere that she went to this school. And you've never heard about it. That is her worth. She knows what she is, who she is. She knows what she carries. And she knows the kind of people that she mingles with. Who are you? And who are you mingling with? What is your worth? Now remember that you are the handmaid of the Most High God.
Amen.
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 You are the chief creature of the Most High God.
Amen.
He fashioned you with his hands and allowed you to live here on earth, giving you everything that you need. You must know your worth. If you don't know your worth, you will be bitten by mosquitoes. You will be driven by fly, and anything will just sway you anyhow. So to free yourself, you must know your worth. You must be an original you. Ha, Karasandaria. You must be an original you, number two. You must be an original you. Don't pretend. Don't fake yourself. Don't be a counterfeit of you. You live and you live in somebody's life. Your own life is there. God, you have one fingerprint. You have one iris. It's only you who has. The generation that came, the ones that are going to come in the future, they don't have your fingerprint. Even if they store your fingerprint in the museum, no one is going to control that fingerprint because you are unique. Amen. In the world. God made you alone. Amen. You must know this, that I am alone. I don't need to copy another person. Amen. People, they move all around, they copy people to be who they are. Ah, Carabas, they are not them. Somebody said, if I don't wear my Jordan, is it my Jordan, they call that boot that they wear on the foot? Then I am no man. If I don't wear Nike, then I am no man. Who told you that you are no man? Who told you that? We must dress ourselves in borrowed robes before we know that we are somebody. No! Don't allow anybody's opinion to confuse you.
Amen.
Amen. Oh, you are a chief creator of the Most High God. The one that Jesus Christ bought with his blood,
Amen.
Precious blood,
Amen.
And set on the cross of Calvary because of you.
Amen.
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 Don't allow anyone to disgrace you. Not at all. You must know who you are.
Amen.
You must identify yourself.
Amen.
Amen. And be your original person. I know we need to make some small inaugurations. Yes, that is true. But don't go and put some other thing that if you don't put that thing, you think that people. During our wedding, please listen to this. During our wedding, one lady went. I don't know whether she was not satisfied with herself or what. She went and bought an extra buttocks and put. And when she came, she was the best dancer there. If you look at the video, you will see how she will dance and set the buttocks and the camera. And it's like this one.
I'll be myself.
Say, I will be myself.
I will be myself.
The third one is exercise self-compassion and practice acceptance. Forgive your own self. Accept yourself the way you are. Don't say, oh, you are looking at another person. This person is more beautiful. This person is more handsome than me. How did God not make me like this? No. Who told you that God will make you like that? Never. Even twins, that they call them identical twins, they are not the same. If you look at identical twins, you cannot identify which one is which one. If this one goes outside, the other one comes in. You will think that it's the one that goes out. You will not still know. And yet, they are not still the same. They have their differences. We must live and accept what we do have. We must accept.